I want to now introduce our first speaker tonight, Dr. Christine Bailey. I first met Christine in October, I think it was. She was a speaker at a Vodafone event that I was running that was for all of the global marketing leaders in their enterprise marketing community. And Christine came and did an amazing talk and allowed herself to be videoed then as well, under duress. Thank you. And I was really, really, really drawn to her style. Her style is very soft and open and collaborative and very different leadership style than I've come across in marketing leaders that I've been lucky enough to experience in the past. So I was very interested in what made Christine as successful as she is. And then I found out more about her role in supporting women and her work as the co-lead for the Connected Women's Network at Cisco, which is a global network. And I read some of her LinkedIn blogs, which are just frankly mind-blowing. And I was just like, we have to have Christine come speak. So I'm really delighted to welcome Christine today. Not only is she all that, she's also the marketing director for EMEA and Russia in Cisco Systems. And that makes her responsible for a long list here. I've written it down. So marketing strategy, financial operations, brand and thought leadership, revenue marketing programs, and partner marketing. She has 24 years experience in B2B technology, and her doctorate is in customer insight from Cranfield. So welcome, Christine. Thank you.
Gosh, that was an intro, wasn't it? So thank you for having me. I thought I would sort of share some, one of my favourite things is, I love a good quote. So hands here, hands up who loves a good quote. We all love a good quote, don't we? So I'm going to tell my story through the medium of quotes. So if we can go to the first one. This is Grace, a couple of people have said this actually, but this is from Grace Hopper. It's better to beg forgiveness than ask permission. Now this was a very early one for me. This was when I was at school and I was doing three A levels, and they introduced a typing class for as they said, the stupid girls who couldn't manage three A levels. And I said, well, I want to do typing. And they said, no, you can't because you're doing three A levels. I'm like, anyway, the person who was running the typing class was my economics teacher. Now I was quite good at economics, so the economics teacher said to me, we'll smuggle you into the class, you'll do the class, you'll take the exam, and nobody will say anything. She was the first one that said to me, it's better to beg forgiveness than ask permission. So I became a qualified typist. How useful was that? I can touch type at speed on a keyboard and have been able to since the age of 17, so I'm pretty fast now. And who could have imagined how useful that would be? And if she had, that advice has come through with me throughout my career is we don't always need to ask permission. And I think in the fast-paced environment that we work in, sometimes we can't wait around for decisions. Sometimes we need to take risks. And as women, we're not quite as good at taking risks as our male colleagues. So that's my first piece of advice is sometimes you just need to do stuff and take some risks and ask forgiveness. What's the worst that can happen? Don't quote me on that one. So if we can have a look at the next one. Tom Hanks. It's supposed to be hard. If it were easy, everyone would do it. Now, this has been something I've always sort of said to myself through, this got me through my toughest physical challenge and my toughest mental challenge. And the toughest physical challenge I did, and that's hence the inspiration for the picture, was climbing Kilimanjaro. And the toughest mental challenge was doing my doctorate. And both of those were endurance tests of completely different types. But sometimes things seem too enormous to us. I think particularly when we're starting out in our careers and we think about what we might want to become and it just seems too big. And I would say just break things down into bite-sized chunks. I had a fantastic guide when I was climbing Kilimanjaro. And we were with a group of Dutch people who were really long-legged and very fast. And on day one, they just left me for dust. And I was thinking, crikey, I'm never going to do this. And the guide said to me, there's no prizes for coming first. It's just to get to the top. And he said, follow me. I'll set the pace. All you have to do is put one foot in front of the other. So the next morning, he set off and set the pace. I thought he was having a laugh. He was going so slowly. And you know what? We set off. And within an hour, we caught up with the Dutch people who were having a rest, and we overtook them. And do you know what? We were the only two out of the whole party that got to the top. And that was purely through, as I say, just, that's all I thought about all the time. I had all sorts of songs going in my head. Ain't no mountain, no, I'm not going to sing. Ain't no but just putting one foot in front of the other, that's what can get you to the top. And I think it was the same with the doctorate, because when you start out, it's a four-year journey. You just cannot imagine how you're going to get to the end of the 4 years. But if you break it down into bite-sized chunks, you break it down into what do I need to do this, you know, this month, this year, this, you know, this project, and you just break it down, and suddenly, you know, you're in the flow, and it becomes clear how to get there. So that's my second piece of advice is, first of all, nothing is ever achieved without hard work. So don't expect things to happen without a lot of hard work. And perseverance is key, but also break things down into bite-sized chunks to make things more manageable. That's my second one, so I can have my next one. John Lennon. Life is what happens to you while you're busy making other plans. And one of my favourite phrases is, have a direction, don't have a plan. Because if you have a plan, they have a habit of not working out. But if you have a direction, your brain will find ways of getting you to where you want to be in ways that you couldn't possibly have imagined. And this has happened to me a couple of times. The first one was with when I was at university, and this is showing my age now, something called the Milk Round, where you would go to a careers fair and everyone would, you know, try and persuade you to come and work for their company. And I was studying German and business studies at university, and particularly marketing. I'm lucky that I always knew I wanted to be in marketing. So I went to Mars, because when you first go into marketing, everybody wants to be in the fast-moving consumer goods, because that's what you think you do when you're in marketing. Creme de la creme of marketing is consumer. So I went to Mars and I said, I really want to work in marketing, but I'm studying German and I'd really like to go work in Germany. And the guy said to me, oh no, you can't do that. I said, well, why not? And he said, well, you have to earn your stripes in the UK first. And then if you earn your stripes in the UK, you show what you're capable of, you might, if you're lucky, get a placement to Germany. And I thought, well, that's not working for me. And as it turned out, I was sponsored by a Swiss German company at university. I managed to get a work placement for them in my year abroad. I made contacts there who were working at Hewlett Packard, and I literally graduated on the Friday from university and started work in marketing in Germany for HP the following Monday. Now, when I had that conversation with the person from Mars, I had no idea that that was going to be the plan, but it perfectly matched the direction that I had. So that was one example, and another example is when I wanted to do the doctorate, and this idea started that, it actually came about from, I knew a marketing professor, I was working with her, I was working in the CRM, customer relationship management world. And I was working with her on a forum, and we were having dinner one night, and she said, you should do a doctorate. And I said, no. I said, no, you have to have an MBA in order to do a doctorate, and I don't want to do an MBA because I know that I want to do marketing. I don't want to do all the other business, finance and operations and stuff. I just want to do marketing. And she said, well, you don't have to have an MBA to do a DBA, Doctor of Business Administration. And I said, well, how does that work then? She said, well, you have to find somebody a professor who wants to support your area of research. You have to do a whole load of extra entrance exams to get in. But it is possible. Right. Okay. And then I was actually on, has somebody heard of Tony Robbins? He's like a okay, right. So I was on one of his weekends that I was, my boss at the time was really into that kind of stuff. And I kind of went kicking and screaming to this weekend at the Excel Centre with 10,000 people, where we got to walk on hot coals, you know, the fire walk. And I had one of these, so I'm going off a slight tangent here, but I'll share this with you anyway. This slightly bizarre moment where 10,000 people are punching the air going, "I am the leader, I will not follow, I am the leader, I will not follow," said 10,000 people, and I'm looking at them going, am I the only one that's getting the irony of this? What he did do for me is, if even though I wasn't kind of really into that whole thing, is it did actually make me dream again, because I'd always dreamt of being a marketing director, and I got my first marketing director role at 31, and I thought, oh, I've got some more years left, hopefully, in this career. I didn't really think beyond this. That had always been the direction, and I'd got to it, and he inspired me to dream big, which I'm already stealing some from the next one, but dreaming big is really important. And that sets your direction. And so I came away from this weekend thinking, well, what do I want to be now? And I thought, I do want to be a marketing guru. Marketing is my passion, it's what I love to do. So how do I get to be a marketing guru? Well, first thought was, well, I need to write a book. And I'm like, well, what do I write a book about? I need some content. I thought, how can I get some content? And suddenly this voice came back, do the doctorate. And then I was like, no, I can't afford it. And your brain starts throwing up objections. No, I can't do that because I can't afford it. But once you set that direction, the brain is a very powerful thing. It will find ways to take you on the right path. So as it turned out, I got headhunted by a company. And I went up, then they said, well, you know, what would be the thing to make you come work for us? And I said, well, I want to do a doctorate, but I haven't figured out how to afford it. And they said, well, come and work for us, and you can work after a year or so, you can work 3 days a week, and then we'll fund you to do the doctorate. Like, happy days. So I handed in my resignation at the firm I was working for, and the CEO said to me, you're not resigning, and we're going to sit here until we figure out what it is that will make you stay. And he said, do you need more money? And I said, I really want to do a doctorate. And he said, well, we'll fund it. I was like, stupid me for not even asking that in the first place. But suddenly I'm there. And that came from not having a direction, which was be a marketing guru, but not being flexible about the plan that would take me there. So that was the next one. Right, this is Steve Jobs. The only way to do great work is to love what you do. And that's my next motto, is you have to love what you do. Life is way too short to spend your time doing something that you don't want to do. And I've always been really lucky that, say, marketing, I knew right from the beginning that that's what I wanted to do. And I've had various, you know, journeys from, I started out working for probably one of the biggest companies in the world, Hewlett Packard, and then getting, as I came back to the UK, getting smaller and smaller. And actually, when I finished my doctorate, I said, I'm never going to go and work for a big corporate company again, and I'm never going to work in an EMEA role. Here I am, 7.5 years later, working for Cisco in an EMEA role. But if you're not happy doing what you're doing, then start the dreaming again. Because, as I say, life is too short, and you will only deliver great work if you're really passionate about what you do and the people that you work with. I need to be working with people that inspire me. It's not just it's the company, it's the culture, it's the people that you work with, the work that you do. That's the next one, and the last one was, act as if what you do makes a difference, because it does. And this is what I say to my team all the time, because we need to feel that we're making a difference. And I think about what is it that makes you, you know, allows you to make a difference. And Chris Dedigo, who used to be our EMEA sales president, he's now global, he talks about knowledge, confidence, risk. And he says, first of all, you need to acquire the knowledge. If you've got the knowledge, it gives you confidence to then take risks. And I think if I think about, you know, what's made a difference for me in my career, it's taking some risks, doing a lot of networking. And I know networking frightens the life out of many women. I was actually speaking at a group like this on networking, and somebody put up their hand and said, networking is my idea of hell. And I said to her, what do you mean by networking? And she said, oh, it's going to watch the rugby, it's drinking with clients, it's going to things, after, in the evenings when I've got the children to look after. And I said, well, that sounds like my idea of hell as well. But that's not what I think of when I think of networking. And networking is, it's about, you know, always taking care of your connections. You know, the person that is working for you today might be your boss tomorrow. It's using social media. I mean, we're great on social media, aren't we? So, but really use your connections, because you can have a fantastic network without leaving your laptop. You know, you can, so make the most of LinkedIn, make the most of Twitter. You know, make sure when you meet people tonight, connect to them on LinkedIn. And left my contact details as well. I'd really encourage you, you know, please connect to me on LinkedIn and connect on Twitter as well. You know, use those networks. The other thing is, I found really useful is to, I'm an avid reader, so I always advise people to read a lot, and that's where I get a lot of ideas and connections, is through reading a lot. The other one is to find mentors. And think about the types of people that you want to have a mentor for, because a lot of people go into a mentorship and they just say, oh, will you be my mentor? And they're not really specific about what they want a mentor for. So do you want a mentor to advise you on your career? Do you want them to advise you on your professional capacity, you know, like marketing or HR or operations or sales, whatever field that you're in? Or do you want somebody who has got a skill set that you don't have that you'd like to learn from? Or do you want somebody who is really well connected within the company, who you think it'll be useful to connect to them? So first of all, be really clear in your mind about what you want a mentor for, and then go and find somebody who role models what it is that you're looking for. And then go and ask them if they'll be your mentor, because it's actually quite tricky when somebody says, will you be your mentor, if they don't really know why they want you to be their mentor. And the best relationships are where you've been clear about what you want, and you've found that someone who really is a role model that you want to learn from. So that's another one of my recommendations. So I actually think that was, I've come to a skidding halt, haven't I, there with the things that I was going to say. I wanted to leave open plenty of time for questions. Absolutely. So I've been made redundant twice, and both of those was not what I wanted at the time, but it actually turned out to be really good for different reasons. So the first one was, I was working for a company called Cambridge Technology Partners, and this is back in the late 90s. They formed as a strategic marketing initiative an online community for CIOs. Wow, online community, that will never take off. They formed it in the US, and I was doing PR for the company at the time, and I met the founder of it, and we just got on like a house on fire. And a year in, he said to me, I need to expand into EMEA. Would you come and, you know, do the marketing and set up the community for me in EMEA? Yes, like a shot. So I got into the online community world really early, but unfortunately it was just ahead of its time. And the company got taken over by another company. They looked to sell off some assets, and they sold it. And honestly, it was the most expensive database that they ever sold, because they didn't take any of the staff. It was in New York. They thought that, why do we need somebody in EMEA? We can run it from New York. And anyway, that turned out to be a very expensive database that they bought. But it meant that I got made redundant. And so I moved into another role within Cambridge Technology Partners, and that actually took me on another career path, which took me in a great direction. So it wasn't what I wanted at the time, but that, you know, it worked out fine. And the same with the doctorate I'd been doing. So I told you the story of the CEO that said, we'll fund your doctorate, you know, if you'll stay. I'm like, yes, happy days. And I went down to working 4 days a week, and 6 months into the doctorate journey, that company was acquired by a bigger company. And they took all of the staff, apart from the marketing director, the finance director, and the managing director, because they already had those roles in the bigger company. So that was a real blow. So it's like, oh my God, where am I? I'm not going to find another company that's going to want to take me on with the doctorate. I'd also realised 6 months in just how much work was involved in doing the doctorate. And that would, you know, that was really tough, and most people don't finish. So that was a real turning point for me. It was, do I go and find another full-time job, or do I give up the corporate world, really dedicate the time to finishing the doctorate, and pick up some part-time work to just to pay the bills? And I actually I was headhunted by a company that I aspired to work for after I got the doctorate. And I went in and met with them, and the CEO actually had a doctorate himself. And I knew it, which is why I'd gone in there to talk with him. And I explained the dilemma, and he said to me, "I'm going to make this decision for you." He said, "It's a hell of a lot of work to do a doctorate. Most people don't finish. I'm not going to give you this job, and you're going to go and finish your doctorate." And that just was the push to give me the courage to give up the day job that was paying the bills, and to find consulting work and really enjoy the doctorate journey, the point about love what you do. And he's one of the people I went back and thanked, actually, when I got my doctorate, to say, "You have no idea how important advice was to me." And it seemed devastating at the time that I lost my job, but actually it was probably the best thing that could have happened to me, because I finished the doctorate in 3 years instead of four, and I really enjoyed doing it. And nobody else finished in the time frame, or even most people didn't finish at all, just because life took over. So sorry, that was a long answer.
If you had to now give your 25-year-old self one piece of advice, what would it be?
What would I give myself? Do you know what? At 25, I left HP because I was working in Germany. And I was the European PR manager, and they had a strong agency network, so I already kind of had the senior role, because most people work with agencies. And I left HP because they didn't have the role that I wanted next, and most people said to me at the time, "You are completely mad, nobody leaves HP, it's a job for life. What are you thinking of?" And I came back to the UK and I joined a very small company, a high-tech PR agency, and people could not get their heads around how I'd done that. And I think that this is almost the other way around, because if I'd go back, I would probably say to myself, "What were you thinking?" But actually, I'm really glad that I was young and stupid, or young and daring. I wasn't aware of kind of the enormity of what I was doing then, but it took me on a path that I will never regret. So I think sometimes you just, that's what I mean about taking, the older you get, the more cautious you get. And so probably that's the advice that I would give, is don't be cautious. You know, you need to take some risks, and you need to experiment, and you need to love what you do. I think I feel very sad for, you know, friends, colleagues who are doing something to pay the bills, and they're not really passionate about what they do. You know, you're only here once, so pick something good.
I've got a question. And your style is very welcoming and very, very open, and you're quite softly spoken. How does that come across in a boardroom full of men?
Yes. So, as you can tell, well, you can't really tell when I've got the microphone, but I am very softly spoken, and I'm a thinker, and I'm not necessarily the person who will shout the loudest in a boardroom, and particularly in a very loud, male-oriented environment. That doesn't work so well for me. Unless you're with someone like, you know, I've been in a smaller company, and the CEO would stop the meeting when everyone was just sales guys, just all, you know, like piling in, going at it, and he'd stop it and he'd say, "Be quiet, I want to know what Chris thinks." And then he'd ask my opinion. But of course, you don't always have that luxury. And when I first came into Cisco, I never thought I was going to survive, because it was full of alpha males, where it was all about who spoke the loudest in the meeting, and who spoke the most, and who spoke the quickest. And it has taken a while to. Well, first of all, it's about being authentic to yourself. I am never going to be that loud, you know, opinionated person in a crowded room. But you find, well, first of all, you find your voice in other ways, and I've always been one to express myself through words in the written form, you know. So I'm loving doing the, you know, the blogging and the thought leadership through social media. But it's also about adapting to your environment and understanding, it's the sort of where being authentic meets adapting to your environment. So, for example, I mean, I really make an effort when I'm in a big group meeting to say more than not necessarily waiting till I've got the really golden nugget that I'm going to share. Is to force myself to really stay in the room. Other thing, techniques are, I love it when we're in a big facilitated room and I'll work with the facilitator and I'll say, it would be really great if you could make everybody stand up when they want to say something. Because I can stand up and get noticed and then I'll speak. But if I've just got to speak, then I'll never get heard. So, I stand up to talk or I put my hand up. And also, I've taken lessons in shouting. Well, it feels like shouting to me. Everyone else tells me it's normal volume, but I've taken lessons in shouting, just to get the volume up. And I think, actually, when I got involved in, there's a couple of women's programs at Cisco called Jump and Dare, which are sort of middle management women's development programs. And they invited me to come and speak because I said I was not the typical Cisco woman. I thought, oh dear. But I kept getting invited back, so it must have come across okay. And people asked me if I would lead Connected Women, and my first reaction was, I'm not the classic female who succeeds, or the classic leader who succeeds at Cisco. Are you sure you want me running Connected Women? And the answer was, that's exactly why we want you running Connected Women. And I can see, since I took it on last year, actually, the culture is really changing at the Cisco as well. We have something called the People Deal, and it's really encouraging a diversity of leader. And I've suddenly, I've got really passionate about this, particularly on topics like the representation of women on boards and quotas. Now, if you'd have asked me a couple of years ago what my opinion was on quotas, I would have said, you should get a job on the merit of you, but it should be the right person for the job. It shouldn't be according to a quota. And the more I read about unconscious bias, it became clear to me that only works if there's no unconscious bias in the person that's hiring. And if you've got a board that is mostly men, they tend to have, without consciously doing it, they are looking for people like them. So unless you force the issue by having a quota, you're going to be dominated by this unconscious bias. So yes, we want to be hired for our merit, but that assumes that the person who's doing the hiring doesn't have an unconscious bias.
Christine, you've mentioned a few times your doctorate and the achievement that it was. Could you say a little about the impact it's had on your career? Did it deliver on your expectation of doing it?
Yeah, that's an interesting one. It's not that anybody... I actually got the job at Cisco. I interviewed at Cisco when I was 9 months pregnant and just handing in my thesis. And when I said I don't want to go and work for a big corporate company, so I wouldn't say it wasn't the doctorate that got me the job. But in actual fact, in some cases, it works against you, particularly with men, because they look at it and they think, oh, she's clever. I now need to prove that I am more clever than she is. And that happens a lot. And actually, some people said to me when I first joined, they're like, well, you don't want to put that down, you don't want to broadcast that because people think you're a know-it-all. I'm like, okay. So I think it was more to do with the skill sets that I learned. So I got to, it's about perseverance. I learned a lot of perseverance. I learned about dealing with complexity. It gave me confidence as well as knowledge. And I'm probably realising it more now, actually, because I published the thesis in 2008, and the things that I predicted then were going to happen in marketing are happening now. So now I can go, I told you so.
That's right.
So yes, it's more, I don't think anybody goes into it with thinking, I'm doing this because it's going to give me a meal ticket in my career. And I think that's probably the wrong reason for doing it as well. I think you go into it because you've got a passion for your topic and you've got a thirst for knowledge and for learning. And then kind of good, you pick up a lot of skills along the way, good things happen from there.
One more question and then we go to the break.
No, I was shocked to hear you were interviewed by Cisco and you were heavily pregnant. How did that go? What was the arrangement? How long maternity leave did you take? How did they hire you?
That was less than ideal. Because, So I interviewed when I was 9 months pregnant. They wanted me to start immediately. Well, clearly wasn't going to work. So I think we eventually negotiated I would start. I was due Christmas Eve, actually. She arrived on the 5th of Jan, so she was 8th last week, a few days ago. And I was due to start in the April, and as it turned out, she didn't arrive till January. So I literally had 4 months. But during that time, I had my viva, and I had to make a whole load of corrections to my doctorate. So I wouldn't recommend that on anybody, having a brand new baby. And I literally have photos of her sitting in this bumbo thing, as it's called, next to my desk while I'm like working on the computer. And my mum was fantastic. She stepped in and helped. So, and this is, I guess that's the other piece of advice, is things don't always happen perfectly. That was far from ideal. It really was. But it was an opportunity that I just that was there and I didn't want to lose. And you know, looking back on it now, it was a very difficult start to a company. But you know, I'm so glad I took the opportunity.
Thank you, Christine. Round of applause.